former President Jamil Mahuad of Ecuador. Jamil Mahuad, welcome.
Thank you.
Take us back to those years in 1998, those months in 1998, very briefly, if you may.
It was a difficult year for Latin America, and the next year, 1990, was going to be even more difficult. We didn't know at that time. Because of the economy, the situation was not good, and especially because of the last war in my country, we were still paying the consequences of that. A very big external debt, a high inflation, the highest in Latin America, and the possibility of an imminent war with Peru again. I was told by the Ecuadorian intelligence sources that they thought that Peru was going to invade Ecuador in the first 2 days of my presidency.
So what did you do? How did you initiate the reform and the change process?
Yeah. Presidential power has a great tool, which is to focus attention of the country and of the people in the elements that the president declares are important. So when the president says, I'm going to address this issue, that issue becomes a part of the national agenda and produce polemic, dialogue, agreements, disagreements, but it is there. I called for a press conference and said, I am traveling to Asunción del Paraguay, and we will have a meeting with President Fujimori to talk about the borderline dispute. A press conference by a president about a topic like that is front page everywhere, both countries. And the media pay attention, and they want to go there, and they travel, and they make a history of the past events, and they make predictions about the future, and they analyze who will be involved in which capacity, with which goals. So the process of information starts flowing, which is very important. So the first purpose of this meeting was to have a personal conversation with President Fujimori. And I was very impressed with the openness of President Fujimori and his disposition to study ways to solve this problem. That gave me hope, because instead of finding a person that was authoritarian or closed or trying to impose some solution, I found a person open to discuss, to explore alternatives. When that atmosphere of dialogue was created, then we needed to work separately in each country with our own fellow Ecuadorians and he with his fellow Peruvians. And that is the process of consultation, information, getting feedback, preparing an action plan, implementing a piece of it, getting feedback, evaluating again, making adjustments, implementing again, receiving feedback. You see, this is never an event. Mm-hmm. Big reforms are processes. And we need a process-oriented mentality.
So it was a process, it was incremental, it was feedback, and then more homework, and then feedback again, and more homework, trying to make progress. What was the time frame?
At the end, we were able to sign a peace treaty 77 days after the day I started as president. We had with President Fujimori 10 meetings in consecutive weeks in 10 different places. In each one, we were advancing with the process. Between meeting and meeting, we have to prepare documents, make consultations, prepare drafts, etc. Talk to people, get feedback. So it was, of course, time-consuming process, but when you have a cost of that level and weight, it is worth to do it.
So for you personally, what was your definition of dignity?
Dignity. The main wound with the Ecuadorian people was not only feeling that the country has been losing territories, but the feeling that the country has been abused, has been forced to sign peace treaties like the Rio Protocol, have signed that treaty while the country was invaded. So the signature was there, but the will was not there. So anything that could be a solution needed to be processed in a different way. We have to agree on something. We will not accept any other imposition. How to create that atmosphere? You need to really go to a dialogue, not to two monologues. Both speak, nobody listens. You need to really pay attention, listen actively, listen with a lot of interest. And the moment you feel that your words have been heard and your words are incorporated in the final document, you feel relieved. Now, for each group, that process needs to exist. But it is my conviction, Nicole, that windows of opportunity really exist. And they are small. They are not always clear windows. Sometimes are like flickering. They are temporary. And they are changing all the time. So when you find the window of opportunity for solving a problem, doing a reform, use it. Because 3 months later, maybe the opportunity will not be there anymore. If I compare this process with other experiences in my life, as mayor of Quito, for example, I would find these common steps, and that would be the first lesson. You need a personal method to deal with things.
Say more about that.
Yeah. You need a system of communication. You need a decision-making process. You need an idea of what leadership is about. You need wills and ways to negotiate. And you need a systemic way of thinking, not a linear way of thinking. The capacity to understand that everything is interrelated. Some variables are more important than others, but in those processes, don't be confused that the events pop up like independent situations. So you need that. Now, that thing needs to be shared at least with your staff, with your group. They need to know how you operate to be more effective. So you will receive the information in the way you need it. They will process things in the way you are more understanding. They know how to persuade you, to what kind of arguments you are more open. You see, mm-hmm. You are helping your group mm-hmm. to help you. Mm-hmm. Second, find a problem. Ask the population. If they say, my main problem in the city of Quito is transportation, we don't have good public transportation, that actually happened. So if that is the problem, let's deal with the problem. Take that from the bag of landscape to the bag of problem. Put it in the agenda. Define the problem appropriately. Create an action plan and implement it.
So was it reinventing or reimagining a narrative from wound and humiliation to hope and fairness and justice and dignity?
What was the most difficult part, I think, Nicole? We had to change even the books that we used to teach history in schools. So it is necessary to separate the accessory from the essential, and to keep the essential because that never changes. But understand that essence would need historically different ways to be expressed.
The essential being?
What you really are, as a person or as a country or as a society. What is the essential thing here? What is the value that we cannot sacrifice? What is the principle we are ready to fight for? Sometimes you do baby steps. Then you have a leapfrog, then baby steps, then leapfrog, or leapfrog, leapfrog, leapfrog. Just be connected with the circumstances. Read the reality and do your best.
We will close with those words. Jamin Wawa, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Nicole.